going to go take it downstairs and for David and have David Letterman and the writers listen to it. Now I have to tell you about our career here. We have Peter and I for 35 years have been standing on the shore watching boats come in, point their way a little bit toward us, and then turn and go. And that has happened many, many times, and we have learned to just wait. It was nice seeing you.
That's fine, because they sail over the horizon, there's a fire in the engine room, and we're glad to be back on the shore.
That's right. Here's a song that's not, and it's sort of, this song has a little bit of that philosophy in it, and it's perennially requested, and I'm always glad to do it.
Yeah.
song, it must have been early 70s. I'm finished writing it around 1980. There were slow writers back then.
No, I remember you doing that. When you were sweet, I remember you playing that for me and for some other people that were playing. We were at a party for that. We used to do a lot of stuff. We'd party with the people from the Art Center, and we played that at Janet Ela's house on the west side. And you played for me. I never heard it before. You just wrote it, but we had written the whole thing, and that was definitely pre 1977. You're a big fat liar.
Last night I did a little Googling, and I looked at the Alice Hotel. St. Alice Hotel was in North Vancouver, and there is a huge high-rise office building there. They tore it down, and it's absolutely nothing like it was, obviously.
We do have a couple pictures that, I'm sorry.
But yeah, we do have pictures, but we don't have any pictures of the inside of there. Uh-uh. And inside, it was real dreary. And it had,
it's only a Canadian bar, even drearier than the worst Wisconsin bar. Really?
They had the plywood cut out palm trees, you know, like here we have the bent over plywood garden hangers. There they have Jimmy Buffett's sort of
there, yeah.
It was really grim. But anyway.
Here's one from the vault. We had to learn this one up again.
This song is in partly in 5/4 time and partly in some other time.
Last week, I think it was. Bananas by the bunch, punch by the pail. Down go the lunch, up go the scale. Bending at the face, the pan fried smells.
On my head.
daffodils. Have I always heard the leather melting on the floor? The dripping of the glaciers in the bottom of my drawer. The groaning of the sidewalk from the surging of the worms. The ticking sound of vengeance from 100,000 germs.
Who am I? Who am I?
Thank you.
teaches you how to make friends with the bugs and how to go crazy without any drugs. It teaches you how, when the law's at the door, to put on a cruel rug and make like the floor. So indoors and everywhere you're not alone, the handbook will help you feel comfy at home.
Hope is cut. Now he is buried in all your
to have. We're buying for children some crayons today, but we can decide between Brenda and Gray.
Songwriters only write about sex. This year's award for the greatest worthless human beings goes to our songwriters. In an era where the earth is being destroyed, children die of hunger, and all but songwriters can compose are songs about copulating. This sends an improper message to our little goats. Our children learn that all that's important in America is intercourse. Education, nature, understanding, even love appear not to matter. A few of us comprehend that songwriters wish to manipulate our society so totally that we become their salivating puppies. Puppies, goats, what? For this I despise these totally talentless people. They lack all creativity. They lack all balance. His name is written on the bottom. I'm not even going to read it. It's nobody I recognize, but I've looked him up, and he apparently is a local poet.
You can tell his name. People are curious now.
I can't pronounce it. Reinhold
Johannes. Reinhold Johannes Kebich. Kebich. This still doesn't help that we tell it. He's had a happy life, I'm sure. We have a whole bunch of stuff. I'm sure you couldn't fail to notice we were sitting.
So
we have a big table full of all of the garbage we've produced over the years. We have in print 12 CDs, and that wasn't. And then we made this last year. We made another edition of our songbook, and then this year. This past year, sometime, we had you all have been asking us for those LP records and whether we were going to ever release them as CDs. And by popular demand, we have had them digitized professionally.
And they're awesome.
And oh, yeah, and Joe has all of them.
And
And actually, Joe is a really good person because a couple of hers didn't play, and we gave them all over again, didn't we? Yeah, so they come back with a guarantee.
Yes,
not that you'll like them, but only that. Okay, enough commercials.
Are they all painted gold?
No. Yeah, they've all been painted gold. So one more song
to take a break, right? And we have to thank you so much for this set. We have another set coming up, a whole another set of, well, we'll sing the same songs probably. This is very nice. This is a very unique evening for us to drag this stuff, this old stuff out again. And thank you. I also very quickly want to thank my wife Christy and Lou's husband Mark, who have helped us get to this point in our career, helped us through all of these posters and all of these years and everything.
And our friends Kitty, and you met Jan and Marianne at the door. They've been helping us a lot these days too. So our posse of people.
You We've been doing this now and then over the years. Yeah, you probably know this one. In the squalor of her awful little shack, she sat with her grungy cat and her parakeet, with rats running round the size of a caribou, playing peek-a-boo with her filthy feet, eating donuts with a spoon and drinking oval tea through a scum of green, floating leisurely. Popping up a plastic from the salad pan, shaking in her hand, out of misery. On the Tommy gun, she didn't need her vegetables. On the Tommy gun, she didn't need her vegetables. Resting on his knee as the roaches and the traffic sang a lullaby. The water pipes would sigh a little harmony, with the stogies he had found wrapped up in cellophane to keep out the rain. When the night was through, he would stumble down the alley picking junk sometimes, or try to beg for dimes on the avenue. In a codeine haze, now she staggers in a stupor through the city streets, wrapped in ratty sheets from her sewing days. Her crazy little face is hidden in the shade of a hat she made from a cardboard box. The hair beneath her hat is so in need of care, it doesn't look like hair, it looks like dirty socks. And it's all because she didn't eat her vegetables. It's all because she didn't eat her vegetables. It's all because she didn't eat her vegetables. As a kid. Or maybe didn't chew them properly, if she did. Her uncle come to see her in his tattered clothes, with a runny nose and a pint of wine, and a bucket full of old heads he had caught that day on Monona Bay with a handheld line. She'd spread a little blanket from the apple crate where they always ate when they had the food. They would eat, they would drink, and when the grub was gone, they would carry on if they were in the mood. And it's all because they didn't eat the vegetables. It's all because they didn't eat the vegetables. It's all because they didn't eat the vegetables.